HarperCollins presents How I Quit Google to Sell Samosas. Adventures with the Bohri Kitchen by Munaf Kapadia with Zahabia Rajkotwala. Read by Rohan Phanse. For my parents, Nafisa and Turab Kapadia, without whom there would be no TBK. My wife, Zahabia Rajkotwala, without you there would be no book. For the Indian housewife, who remains the most precious yet under-acknowledged asset our country has, thank you from the bottom of my heart for being the last custodian of our cuisine and tradition. Foreword by Rashmi Uday Singh on 24th February 2021. First of its kind, memorable, not only describes my finger-licking shortcut-to-bliss meal at Munaf Kapadia's The Bohri Kitchen, but also this book that you're listening to. In fact, this book is as much of a multidimensional extravaganza as my 3-hour-long, 8-course, guilt-free, non-stop thal lunch. It was a taste of Daudi Bohra culture and exciting commentary on the rare ingredients and their cooking and eating customs. As is this book. It's more. Much more. My introduction to the Munaf magic was all thanks to my friend Rishi Kapoor, the gourmet of all gourmets, the high-octane, award-winning charismatic actor who had 4 generations of film and foodie genes. I write this with gratitude to Rishi. It's thanks to his passion and gourmet gusto that I discovered the Bohri Kitchen and shared the experience in my Bombay Times column, on social media, and even created a Bohri Food Award category for the Times Food Awards, now Times Food and Nightlife Awards. And now, it gives me equal joy to share this book. The catchy title, How I Quit Google to Sell Samosas, does not even begin to express the multi-course thal of messages that the book serves up. A riveting personal story. It's a family saga. The cook is the mom, that's Nafisa. The head of operations is the father, that's Turab. And the CEO, abbreviation for Chief Eating Officer, is the son Munaf. Munaf, one of 4 siblings, inherited his father's entrepreneurial genes. His father built his business from the ground up, eventually buying out a wholesale business from Munaf's grandfather. From competing with 300 candidates vying for a coveted, client-facing role at Google's New Delhi and Mumbai offices to almost being fired from the company, Munaf displayed tremendous entrepreneurial spirit in the initial years. Quite clearly, the job as an account strategist wasn't cutting it, even if it was, in his own words, the best company in the world to work for. His life story is an inspirational one for those mired in a 9-to-5 job and looking to unleash their entrepreneurial spirit. Motivational masala. Munaf stirs into his food story motivational masala for budding entrepreneurs. All the hazards, the ups and downs, loans, home dining experiences, to delivery kitchens, to raising private equity are honestly and impeccably recorded. It's a brilliant blueprint for all startups. The food story unravels, just like the alternating courses of Khara's Meethas, Savory Sweet, in our leisurely lunch. It's sprinkled with humor too. From taxes to tacos. Call it serendipity, call it synchronicity, but it all comes together in a sublimely delicious way. My life story is on the same lines as Google to Samosas, except that mine is from taxes to tacos. Having qualified as a journalist from Bombay University, I went on to write the IAS exam and, through my days with the income tax department in Mumbai, continued to explore the city through its restaurants and write about them. When I quit the income tax department to start a weekly column in the Bombay Times and do TV shows, I was criticized for quitting a powerful job to write about brownies. Just like Munaf was. Food writing was not fashionable then, and there was no internet. I wrote India's first ever city restaurant guide, and it went on to become a national bestseller. Though I've written over 40 books and hosted many a food show since, I have never had to face the entrepreneur's dilemmas that Munaf dealt and continues to deal with. Kudos to him for keeping his head above water. All through my writing career, my passion has always been the home chef. Over 30 years ago, when I started my column in the Bombay Times, I insisted on an answering machine for readers to call in and share their home chef favorites. It thrills me to no end that, with TBK, Munaf bridges the gap between a home chef and restaurateur brilliantly, serving up not only a unique, memorable experience, but also this magnificent multi-course book, which you are now listening to. Chapter 1. The Day I Quit Google. It happened quite unexpectedly. I remember the date, 15 June 2015. The months leading up to it had been a seismic period for me, professionally. After 4 years with Google India, in Hyderabad and then Mumbai, I was contemplating a move within the company to one of their many foreign offices. In those months, I would find myself battling this inexplicable feeling, one that had led me to quit my previous job. I couldn't stop thinking that my current role at Google, that once had me burning the midnight oil, now took up less than half my office hours. Vikas Agnihotri, my super boss, pulled me into one of the conference rooms at the Mumbai office. Footnote: Vikas Agnihotri subsequently went on to become the head of Google India. He is currently India's first operating partner at SoftBank Investment Advisors. Back to the text. He sat me down and said, "We have heard a lot about the Bohri Kitchen, Munaf, and we want to know what you have planned for its future." I was caught off guard. "I'm sure you are too. What is the Bohri Kitchen? And why did my super boss concern himself with it?" An hour later, I made the fateful decision to quit Google. The story of how I quit Google begins at the end of the 2010 placement season at Mumbai's Narsi Monji Institute of Management Studies, also known as NMIMS. Along with 20 other students, I had spent countless hours over 2 months in freezing cold, air-conditioned classrooms, waiting to be interviewed by company reps. The dull white lights in the old MBA building cast a gloom over the recruitment process, cranking up our anxiety levels by several notches. The new structure, which resembles an airport hangar, was still under construction. Every candidate went through a couple of interviews followed by a moderated group discussion with competing candidates. The selection criteria was simple. Did you possess the technical know-how for the job? And in case you didn't, were you at least smart enough to be trained for the job? Did you play well with others? An assessment of your leadership and managerial skills. Did you have passable communication skills? Inevitably, most of us needed assistance in this area after joining. Business emails are tough. Everyone in business school had stars in their eyes when they saw a future as a management trainee at a multinational company, also known as FMCG MNC. Getting placed at a Hindustan Unilever, also known as HUL, or Procter & Gamble, also known as P&G, is what dreams were made of for us dewy, blazer-donning MBA grads. Very few of us knew what really motivated us. I mean, yes, some of us liked marketing, others enjoyed numbers, so maybe finance. Then there were the rare few who were drawn to human resources, also known as HR, and the crazy ones who considered advertising. What any of this actually meant in terms of real work and whether we would enjoy it, well, I'm not sure if anyone had any clarity there. We still had to pretend we did to bag the job though. Fake it till you make it. By the summer of 2011, I had graduated from NMIMS's MBA in marketing management program and secured a placement as management trainee at Wrigley India Private Limited, a mass company. I was officially in the business of selling chewing gum. The role was an incredible opportunity for me to grasp the ground realities of an FMCG, that is fast-moving consumer goods business, before assuming a managerial position in its sales hierarchy. More importantly, for the first time ever, I got a taste of life away from home. All the trainees who were a part of Wrigley's summer intake that year attended an orientation program in Gurgaon, where we were also allocated our respective assignments for the quarter. Then, like a vigorously shuffled deck of cards, we were evenly distributed across the north, south, east, and west of India. I was stationed south in rural Mysore, now Mysuru, Karnataka, to shadow a regional sales officer whose name was Lingaraju. I was tasked with learning the ways of chewing gum selling and reporting back to the head office with my insights and recommendations. My stint in Mysore with Wrigley often felt like an expedition on the Amazing Race. I had no understanding of the regional tongue, Kannada, or any idea of how to find my way around this remote region. Lingaraju doubled up as both Phil Coogan and my teammate, assigning me tasks on one hand, sell gum, and helping me complete them on the other. Bribe retailers with a bucket to display your gum. Footnote: Phil Coogan is the renowned host of the Amazing Race series and has been with the show since its inception in 2001. Back to the text. He also threw in useful tips on where to eat and shop and sightseeing in the vicinity. 3 months in Mysore taught me many things about myself and the job at hand. It also taught me that Lingaraju could climb a coconut tree, secure the fruit, and climb down in under a minute. Footnote: meeting Lingaraju is the best memory I have of my Mysore experience. In the few days we spent together, we became really tight. He invited me into his home, and his family plied me with freshly cooked mango rice and dal. It was amazing to see small town life from his point of view, strengthening my impression that South India is definitely superior in terms of gender balance, literacy and safety as compared to other parts of India. The most remarkable thing about my visit to Lingaraju's home, though, had to be a cow sitting in his living room. Back to the text. But perhaps the most important thing I learned is that I needed to genuinely believe in a product if I'm going to try and sell it. Despite all the fun and games, as the weeks wore on, I found myself getting increasingly restless. At Wrigley, I was one among four trainees on the fast track to becoming an area manager. I was getting paid exceptionally well, living by myself across the country, and was on a high-flying corporate career track. I thought this would be the year that I turned into that independent, ambitious, bright-eyed 22-year-old protagonist you see in Hollywood coming-of-age movies. Ironically, almost 8 years later, I'm still very much living with my parents and continue to exploit their hospitality shamelessly. While Wrigley probably sells the best chewing gum out there, it wasn't sticky enough for me to endure sleepless nights poring over sales targets or frequent rotations in different parts of the country. In hindsight, I can see that I've always had an issue with a conventional sales role. Till date, my father narrates the story of my placement interview with a leading tobacco company, which I happened to ace. But when the interviewer asked me, "Munaf, how would you feel working for a company that is selling a product that kills lakhs every year?" I had no response. I realized I couldn't do it and asked if I could use my humble talents to sell their biscuits instead. For me, it's more than just achieving a target. It's also about evangelism and education. I needed a brand, a product, or a service which I could truly evangelize. As an employer today, I'm always wary when it comes to hiring freshers, because if there is one thing my Wrigley experience taught me, it's that your first job gets you ready for the next one. management schools don't do enough to draw out your professional strengths and weaknesses. But your first job does that to a great extent. You accept the role, praying to God, or whatever else gets you going, that you have done right by yourself and your employer. When you finally spend time earning that paycheck, sitting down for appraisals and considering the possibility that this might be 5/7 of your life, you are inwardly compelled to evaluate what really motivates you and activates those creative juices. As luck would have it, 3 months into my time at Wrigley, I got a call from the recruiters at Google India to interview for a position at their Hyderabad office. I was conflicted about job hopping this early in my career. I had barely spent any time on my first assignment at Wrigley, so quitting now felt impulsive. I had no real complaints here. In fact, the leadership had put together a genuinely good management trainee program with a goal to shape us into skilled executives. But the lure of working for a tech giant with roots in Silicon Valley was irresistible. I could also blame what happened next on the grass is always greener on the other side syndrome. In this instance, making the decision to interview with Google put me on a path that made no logical sense, career or growth-wise, but turned out to be the best decision I have ever made in my life. The first time I visited the Google campus in high-tech city Hyderabad, I was mesmerized. They had leased an entire building, 10 stories high, with a gleaming glass facade. Walking from the main entrance to the lobby, you pass a massive cafeteria on the ground floor. Enclosed by floor-to-ceiling glass, visitors are offered a glimpse of hundreds of Googlers browsing an almost infinite number of culinary options. I often wonder whether the decision I made 4 years later to become a food entrepreneur was influenced by the gastronomic experiences I had at Google. As I walked past the cafeteria, I fell in love with what I saw. Googlers. I felt that energy that one experiences on a college campus. One that is young and vibrant, enhanced by individuals with stellar IQs, winning personalities, and a genuine passion for what they do. It was evident that every person on that campus was the best in class for their role at Google. I was already excited to interact with and learn from them. The path to becoming a Noogler wasn't smooth. Footnote: new Googlers or freshers are called Nooglers on Google campuses the world over. Back to the text. I survived 3 rigorous rounds of interviews while I was still working at Wrigley and living in Mysore. Then came what was to be my very first pay negotiation with Google HR. They had offered me a position. Yay! But at a 40% pay cut. Nay, from what I was making at Wrigley. When I asked them to reconsider, I received this polite response. We are sorry we can't match your expectations right now, but you can always apply again next year. Like hell. I signed my employment contract with Google the very next day. I haven't seen a more effective use of reverse psychology ever since. The roadblocks didn't end here, however. I had to tactfully and patiently convince my parents that this sudden decision to quit a well-paying job at a multinational company within 3 months of joining wasn't me having a meltdown. At first, they were convinced that I was being short-sighted, probably overwhelmed, or just plain scared by what real employment and hard work looked like. We also discussed how this move didn't make any sense career-wise. Wrigley was offering a significantly bigger paycheck. I was trading my title of management trainee for account strategist. There were only 3 other management trainees at Wrigley. Google India, on the other hand, employed hundreds of account strategists. In hindsight, I think my parents were absolutely right. This made no logical sense. In a book titled How to Wreck Your Own Career Graph, this would probably rank as chapter one. And yet...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.